He said, my name is Steve Bunting, and it's my pleasure to introduce Mike. Mike and I have known each other quite a few years now. He brings 30 years plus of Idaho botany and floral experience to us. He's a graduate from the University of Idaho, got his master's in at the U of I. He started here in Idaho, working for the Idaho Department of Fish and Game with the Conservation Data Center. And really, that's where I first ran into him when he and I were both working on Lepidium papilliferum quite a bit. And currently, he is a freelance botanist working on a number of projects in Idaho and adjacent states. So with that, please welcome Mike Mancuso.
All right, thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here in Moscow. All right, so I have to get the screen set up here so I know what's going on.
I'm going to show this one. Look here.
Well, they're working on that. Mike has rock.
I see that any of the advanced this
thing. Rare plants of Idaho that are published by the BLM for free copies up here for people to grab if they like. These plants are going to go to Nancy. They are in recognition of your leadership and of your award. They are aspen. One day they will have roots.
Well, again, thank you very for everybody for coming tonight, and also for folks watching via Zoom. Tonight's topic is Idaho's endemic plants. So these are plants that occur in Idaho and nowhere else in the world, at least not as natives. And as such, they really are a unique part of the biological heritage of the state. In the context of plant geography, an endemic is a plant that occurs in a specified area and nowhere else. So it's inherently a scale dependent concept. For example, it'd be okay to say arrowleaf balsam root is endemic to the Pacific Northwest, but it would be inaccurate to say arrowleaf balsam root is endemic to Idaho, because it not only occurs in Idaho, but occurs in a number of other states and provinces. Plant distribution patterns and endemism have multiple factors play into them. The classic study of endemism in the California flora found the highest rates of endemism in areas that had the highest diversity of plant habitats. Many endemic plants in Idaho and elsewhere are found on uncommon or odd substrates or other kind of rare or weird edaphic conditions, such as serpentine soils or ash outcrops. The highest rates of endemism in the world are found on oceanic islands, such as Madagascar, Hawaii, New Caledonia. And this points to the importance of genetic isolation to foster endemism. Other factors that influence endemism include its phylogenetic and genetic reasons. In the West, aridity seems to play a role. So again, there's multiple factors that go into the distribution patterns, including endemism. Sorry. Let's see. Little hitch here. But before I get into talking about any specific Idaho endemics, I always want to go over maybe some general patterns regarding the endemic flora of Idaho. And just starting off with, based on the USDA plants database, there are about 3,200 plant species in Idaho. And of those 3,200 or so, a little over 2,700 are native and nearly 500 are introduced species. And based on the second edition of Flora Pacific Northwest and Intermountain Flora, we have 69 endemic species in Idaho, which is about 2% of the flora. And of those 69, 29 are what I call local Idaho endemics. These are plants that have a distribution, a worldwide distribution of about a 25-mile radius or less. The other 40 are what I call regional Idaho endemics, which are plants that are endemic to Idaho, but have a distribution that's more than 25-mile radius. But as we all know, state boundaries rarely follow ecological boundaries. So by limiting our discussion to state endemics, we miss out on at least 10 additional local endemics centered in Idaho that extend to adjacent states. An example is centennial rabbit brush at the bottom of the screen. This is a plant that occurs in this handful of populations in the southern Beaverheads, north of Du Bois, Idaho. Right along the Kanzel Divide. Most plants are on the Idaho side of the divide, but there's one population where a few plants get into the, across the divide, a couple hundred feet into Montana, so it's no longer an Idaho endemic. There's at least 75 additional regional endemics that occur in Idaho, extend to adjacent states. And these are plants that have a greater than 25-mile distribution radius, up to about maybe 100-mile distribution radius. And many of the Palouse endemics fall into this category, including example up here, Jessica's aster. There's a lot of ways to look at or analyze Idaho's endemic flora. One of them is from a taxonomic perspective. So out of those 69 endemic plant species, they're represented in 23 plant families. But notice that five families, the aster, borage, mustard pea, and plantain families, those five families account for 2/3 of all Idaho endemics. And that astragalus with 11 species alone accounts, the genus astragalus alone accounts for 16% of Idaho endemic flora. We have several other genera that have multiple endemics, including Jaba with 5 and Penstemon with 4 species. So another way to look at the endemic flora is by life form. And this slide, I think, clearly shows that the great majority of Idaho endemics are perennial forests. We have like no endemic trees in Idaho, for instance. Looking at it from a kind of a gross habitat perspective, this slide demonstrates that Idaho endemics lean towards the dry end of the gradient versus wet, and that rocky habitats are a really important contributor to Idaho's endemic flora. From a geographic perspective, this map of Idaho kind of shows a number of endemics in each of these 6 floristic divisions, and which are based on a kind of an abridged version of a plant distribution map that Barbara Erd and Bob Mosley made back in the early 1990s. that was based on general vegetation and floristic patterns in Idaho, supplemented by climate, geology, and soils data. And so North Idaho on this map then is the area that was covered by the continental ice sheets during the Pleistocene. North Central Idaho is basically the Clearwater Mountains and associated ranges, but also extending into the Palouse area and some of the Columbia River basalt flow areas. West Central Idaho is basically the southern lobe of the Idaho batholith, extending down into the little bit of the Payette region, and is dominated by the Salmon River Mountains and some other mountain ranges like the Sawtooths and Boise Mountains. East Central Idaho is everything east of the batholith, the mountains and valleys east of the batholith. This is an area of really complex and diverse geology with a metamorphic volcanic and sedimentary rocks, and also the highest mountains in the state. Southwest Idaho is the lowest Snake River Plain and the Owyhee Country. This area has less exposed lava and much more sedimentary rock compared to Southeast Idaho, which encompasses the upper Snake River Plain, as well as the numerous mountain ranges that extend from the South Hills all the way to the Montana border. What I want to do with this slide is just to show you a comparison for the Idaho endemic flora to adjacent states. And you can see that Idaho's 2% is pretty similar to most other Western states, but really pales in comparison to California and really, especially to places like Hawaii, where 80% of the flora is endemic. And by the way, that used to be 90%, but well over 100 species of endemics of Hawaii are now extinct. And there's about 200 more species with less than 50 plants left in the wild. So that number of endemics will be going down over time. And just another little aside, even though Hawaii has much less than 1% of the land mass of the United States, it has over 40% of all the federally listed threatened endangered species of plants. So Idaho can do better than that. You don't have to worry about this. This is just kind of a slide to remind me to say we have 6 to 9 endemic plants in Idaho. Each one has a story to tell. So tonight we're going to look at a few of those stories, hear a few of those stories. I've tried to include plants from around the state, including Northern Idaho, to talk about tonight. And I've also emphasized some species that are relatively new endemics, newly described species that you may be less familiar with. We're going to start in North Idaho, work our way south, bang a right, head over to Eastern Idaho. Whoops, it will work. Thank you. So we're going to start off with the plant that's most northern Idaho endemic, Robinson starwort. It's a plant in the carnation family gets to about a foot tall. It has these opposite leaves that are attached directly to the stem, small white flowers that bloom in the late spring, early summer. Its distribution is limited to 3 counties in northern Idaho. Most known populations occur in the St. Mary's River drainage or some of its tributaries. It's one of those plants that may be more common than we know, but there's been limited, targeted searches for this species. And some of you might know Pseudostellaria jamesii, the sticky starwort. It looks a lot like this plant, but it has glands in the inflorescence where this one doesn't. And the interesting about that is that's a very widespread common species, the sticky starwort. You know, it's all over Idaho and places, but apparently its distribution does not overlap with Robinson's starwort. The habitat for this species is described as just stream banks and river banks, you know, within conifer forests, or at least conifer forests nearby. The story for Robinson starwort begins in 1898 when Benjamin Lincoln Robinson described Stellaria oxyphylla. Robinson was spent most of his career as curator of the Harvard Herbarium starting in the 1890s. So he had a very prominent career. But really, after his description of Stellaria oxyphylla, the plant was more or less forgotten about. And even when Hitchcock did his treatment for the Carnation family for Vasco plants in Pacific Northwest, he did not think it was a valid taxon and considered just an extreme form of another plant, Stellaria calycantha. But more recent work associated with the Flora of North America project reevaluated it and determined that Stellaria oxyphylla actually is a distinct species and that its proper name is Pseudostellaria oxyphylla. The genus Pseudostellaria itself has about 20 species, most in Asia and Europe, but three species in North America. One of them right here in Northern Idaho. Staying in North Idaho, our next endemic is Constans's bittercress, Cygamini constansii. Again, there's another plant that gets maybe up to about a foot tall, has these coarsely lobed oval leaves and white to pinkish flowers. It's endemic to North Central Idaho and is associated with what's commonly referred to as the Greater Clearwater Refugium. The heart of the refugium is the canyons, lower canyons of the Lacsaw, Selway, and North Fork Clearwater River drainages, which represent the first mountain, seaward-facing mountain canyons south of the great glaciers that came down from Canada. So that was their refugia, some of these plants. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. Its habitat is open, partly shaded to shaded, moist conifer forest, usually dominated by Western red cedar. And I should say that the refugium itself is in forest ecosystem, you know, relatively moist, warm conditions, renowned for its large number of coastal disjunct plant species, as well as a number of endemic taxa. This species is named after Lincoln Constans, who was an eminent plant taxonomist who made the type collection. Dr. Constans spent most of his career at the University of California, Berkeley, but early in his career, he actually spent 3 years at Washington State College, as it was called then, and had a number of grad students who went on to be pretty prominent themselves. Staying in North Idaho is another endemic evergreen kittentail, Cynthris platycarper. It's recognized by its roundish scallop leaves that are evergreen, these really deeply incised petals and fruits that are also deeply bilobed. This species this genus Cynthris is one of many that used to be in the figwort family, Scrophulariaceae, but has now been moved to the plantain family, Plantaginaceae. This species was discovered by Floyd Gale from the University of Idaho back in 1936 on Coolwater Mountain. It's in the kind of a part of that divide between the lower Lhasa and Solway. Lewis and Clark explored Clearwater Country on their great, you know, adventure and collected some plants. But for many years after that, the upper Clearwater Country was very poorly botanically explored. And this began to change after the early 1930s, when a road that would eventually become Highway 12 was built, at least partway up to Lowell. And once this happened, the University of Idaho sponsored expeditions into that country. And it was during one of those expeditions that Floyd Gale discovered this plant. And about a year after that, less than a year after that, he teamed up with Francis Pinnell, who at that time was the world's authority on the Scrophulariaceae, the figwort family. They published this as a new species in 1937. And Francis Pinnell, he was associated with the National Academy of Sciences in Philadelphia. So this plant's endemic to the Clearwater Mountains in north central Idaho. Oops, wrong way. Its habitat is really part of what's called the Grand Fir Mosaic. This is a habitat where Grand Fir is the dominant conifer, and there's these natural openings dispersed in the forest canopy of various sizes and shapes, with bracken fern, Sitka alder, and Fool's Huckleberry, like shown here, as some of the common species in those openings. One of the more remarkable endemics, in my opinion, is Idaho phlox, Phlox idahoensis. It's a phlox that's about a meter tall, which is more than twice the height of any other phlox native to Pacific Northwest. It has these really showy kind of lavender-colored flowers that terminate the stem. But monitoring has showed that only about 1 to 5% of the stems actually flower in a given year. It has one of the most restricted distributions of any Idaho endemic, known from about a 3 mile radius area near the unincorporated town of Headquarters up in the North Fork Clearwater Country. And that's it. Where it occurs in a series of these moist montane meadows, you know, surrounded by Grand Fir or Western Red Cedar Forest. Do it again. Idaho phlox was described by Edgar Wery back in the 1940s. He was a very well-published geologist, chemist, and botanist who taught at the University of Pennsylvania for many, many years. I think he had over 400 publications. The phlox was one of his botanical specialties, and at one point he tried to get phlox named as the official flower of the United States, but he lost out to Rose. Dr. Wery, like some of his contemporaries, because of the large size of Idaho phlox, assumed it was most closely related to species from large phlox species that are native to the East and Midwest, such as Phlox maculata and Phlox carolina. But some genetic molecular research about 20 years ago found his closest relative is actually Phlox longifolia, longleaf phlox, which many of you probably know. It's common in this part of the world and up in the West, and you know, never gets more than even less than a foot tall. And so it's just a very interesting story there, I think. Well, if you haven't been to Waldy Mountain on an IMPS field trip, maybe you've seen this plant, Dobermeyer's Daisy Notice. It's in the borage family, has white flowers and fruits that have these kind of stiff hairs on the back of the fruit. And that's what gives this plant its name, actually. In Greek, daisies is hairs, noton is on the back of something. And so you put those two together, you get Daisy Notice. And Daisy Notice is what they call a monotypic genus, which means there's only one species in the whole genus, and that's it. This is Dobermeyer's. And it's the only endemic genus in Idaho flora. It's another one with a very limited distribution in Idaho County, known from the Selway Loxaw country, on a few mountaintops or high ridges. Its habitat is these natural clearings, often from wildfire, but also now in clear cuts and along roads. I think this picture is from an old IMPS field trip, actually, back in the day. The species is named after Rexford Dobermeyer, who was a prominent ecologist who taught at the University of Idaho for about 10 years. Before moving over to Washington State University for nearly 30 more years. He made the type collection in 1946, shown here in this image from Waldy Mountain. Dr. Dobermeyer was probably most well known for his classification of grassland and forest vegetation that used based on habitat types versus, which is potential vegetation, versus vegetation that's on the ground at the time. When he first came up with this, it was quite controversial and pretty radical thinking, but it has withstood the test of time, and a lot of agencies and natural resource folks still use habitat typing. Dr. Dobermeyer's wife, Jean, was an important collaborator for him throughout his career, and they published quite a few papers together. After they retired in 1975, at some point, they moved to Central Florida. And as this photo on the bottom of the image, this slide shows, they kept up their advocacy and conservation, even in Florida. And there's even a trail named after them down in Florida now. So a legacy that carries on. John Heine Christ worked for the then called the Soil Conservation Service in Idaho for many years. And during that time, he collected over 20,000 plants in Idaho, which is probably more than anybody else ever has. One of those collections was a Douglasia he got from Idaho County, shown here in this image, the slide, that remained unnamed for a while. And when Charles Leo Hitchcock was preparing his treatment for Primulaceae, in 1961, he looked at this sheet from John Christ and thought it could be a new species of Douglasia, but he didn't have enough material to do anything about it. So it was not until 20 years later, in 1981, that Douglas Henderson, one of Hitchcock's students, finally was able to get more material and describe it as a new species, Idaho Douglasia. It's a mat forming plant with succulent leaves and these really vivid pink magenta flowers. A really quite stunning plant in the primrose family. It's endemic to the central Idaho mountains, kind of a discontinuous sort of pattern. It's known from an upper Selway country, and then the Gospel Hump country, and then extending down into the Boise Mountains in Elmore County. So it's known from the Nez Perce and Boise National Forest, but not the intervening Payette National Forest. Though a lot of us have looked for it there for over the years, it's still that gap. It's a subalpine species. It grows in subalpine ridges and mountaintops and upper slopes in this well-drained gravelly soils that derives from decomposed batholith granite. These sites are often along the margins or in openings in the subalpine forest. You can see from this one image that it can be kind of locally common, but most populations have no more than 1,000, maybe 2,000 plants. This the genus Douglasii is named after David Douglas, I'm sure many have heard of, a famous botanical explorer in the early 1800s who made many discoveries during his time in the Pacific Northwest. Lomatian is a genus that's endemic to the Western United States, or Western North America, excuse me. There are about 75 species of Lomatian, which makes it by far the largest genus in the parsley family in the United States, in North America. We have about 31 species of Lomatian in Idaho. Two of them are endemic, Lomatian idahoense, which I'm not gonna talk about tonight, Idaho Lomatian, and then this guy, Swinger's Biscuit Root, Lomatian swingeri. It has this thick tuberous root, yellow flowers that bloom early in the spring, early than any other Lomatian in that where it grows. But the really diagnostic feature about this plant are the leaves. They're all kind of on one side of the stem and have these points at the tip. And anybody who's ever tried to key out an unknown Lomatian can attest to, usually need the mature fruits to be positive identification. And for this species, the fruits are quite a bit longer than they are wide. Like you see in that photo. There's another one dot species. It's known from one population in the whole world. On the Joseph Plains, which is a kind of plateau of land between the Salmon and Snake River Canyons, about 20 miles east of Grangeville. And that's it. Its habitat is a dry, rocky meadow within a ponderosa pine woodland ecosystem. Its restriction to this one meadow complex gives Swinger's Biscuit Root the distinction of being the most the smallest distribution of any Idaho endemic plant. I got to keep coordinating between my fingers here. Moving a little further south, we come to our next Idaho endemic, Salmon River stone crop, Sedum valens. The succulent, the numerous succulent leaves and the bright yellow flowers make this, I think, a stunning plant. It's distinguished from other regional stone crops by a large rosette of basal leaves that can be up to 4 inches wide. And it's also one of only two stone crops in North America that have hairs along the margins of the leaves. Again, if this is another one known for only really a handful of populations along the Salmon River Canyon, upstream from Riggins. That's it. Its habitat is rock crevices in the canyon, on the canyon walls, and also in duff beneath ponderosa pine or Douglas fir in the woodlands that come down to the canyon. This species was discovered by Curtis Bjork, a name I'm going to mention a few more times tonight. He was affiliated with the University of Idaho at the time, back in the early 2000s. And he found this plant, a new species, along a well-traveled road corridor. So that should tell us all something. Got to keep your eyes open. The sedges, the genus Carex, is a gigantic group of plants. There's over 2,000 species of sedge in the world, mostly in temperate and boreal regions. We have nearly 100 species of sedge in Idaho, which makes it the most speciose genus in our flora. And I'm sure a lot of you have seen sedges in your hikes through Idaho, but I'm willing to bet very few of you have ever seen Indian Valley sedge, the Carex aboriginum. It's one of the rarest plants in our flora. It's actually a kind of a large sedge, as the photo shows, kind of a bunch grass habit. It also has separate male and female spikes and is relatively large perigynia, these special structures that have this prominent beak. This plant was first discovered by Mark, the intrepid botanist Marcus Jones, in 1899 in Indian Valley, east of Cambridge, Idaho. The plant was not seen for many decades again. And then it actually was thought to maybe be extinct after some surveys in the 1990s failed to find any populations. And then, almost quite amazingly, Curtis Bjork, then a grad student at the University of Idaho, found a population near the small town of Mesa in Adams mm-hmm. County. And to me, the amazing thing about this, he rediscovered the plant. One day difference from exactly 100 years from Marcus Jones' collection. I can't remember if it was one day before or after Marcus Jones' collection. Yeah, so quite remarkable in 1999. After Curtis's discovery, surveys by the BLM, Forest Service, Fish and Game folks found about 10 more populations, mainly in around Council, extending down into Washington, the northern part of Washington County. And that's it. Most of these populations are quite small, with fewer than 100 plants. So it's a really rare plant. Its habitat is these ephemerally wet areas, such as long intermittent creeks, seeps, and some areas that get some sub-irrigation part of the year. They're basically transitional from really wet, flooded habitats to dry uplands. Moving now into Southwest Idaho, I'll talk about one of our newest additions to the Idaho endemic list, and that's Boise sand verbena, Abronia mellifera, variety pahoviorum. This is a member of the 4 o'clock family. It has these white to pinkish, night blooming, mildly fragrant, trumpet shaped flowers. They're in this really pretty head, umbel like head. And it has these 4 or 5 large, distinct, so not fused, bracts subtending the inflorescence. And that is one of the characters that distinguish it from related species. This one is endemic to Southwest Idaho, north of the Snake River, kind of from Boise to Horseshoe Bend, Emmett to New Plymouth, and that's it. Where it's really known from not that many populations, and there's a conservation concern. Its habitat is these old lake bed sediments and sands. Up in the lower foothills, up to about 4,000 feet elevation. For many years, this plant was thought to be, it was just misunderstood, I guess. It passed as a different species, Abronia fragrans, which is a widespread common species. And it wasn't until about 10 years ago that Barbara Erda, a person maybe some of you here know, a plant taxonomist from Boise, started looking at this plant around Boise, in the Boise area, more carefully. And being an astute observer, Barbara noticed that the plants that she was looking at in the Boise area were different. Based on some morphological, geographical, and molecular data, Barbara and her collaborator, Sonia, described it as a new species in a new variety in 2016. But notice how the title of this paper says of conservation concern. And that's really the case. It's known from, I think, 20, maybe 20 sites, but more than half of those have not been seen in more than probably 30 years based on old collections, what I should say. I haven't been looked at for a while. The population we do know about, they're all pretty small, usually less than 100 plants. And for this plant, another problem is that its distribution coincides with areas that are prime real estate for development in the Treasure Valley. And on top of that, it's areas that haven't been developed yet have been severely degraded by weeds such as cheatgrass, cereal rye, and rush skeleton weed. So this is a plant that seems to be in trouble. Recognizing this, the Pahovi chapter of IMPS last year collaborated with Boise City Parks and Recreation to look for this plant on City of Boise property, as well as some adjoining BLM state and private lands that are public access. Unfortunately, we didn't find any populations. This year, we intend to look at on some BLM lands closer to Horseshoe Bend and Emmett as we continue surveying for this. But from what we know now, it seems to be one of those plants that's its conservation status is really up in the air. Well, if any of you have been to Craters of the Moon in the springtime, late springtime, you have seen this plant, Craters of the Moon buckwheat, as part of the really wonderful wildflower display that contrasts so vividly against the black cinders of Craters. It's quite a stunning plant. Has anybody not been to Craters and seen this plant? Yeah, you probably have, whether you know it or not, it's common there. It has these cream flowers that often fade to kind of orange, and these basal leaves that get up to a foot wide. But for many years, this plant passed as an odd expression of Areognum alvellifolium variety depressum, which is actually a plant typically found in high in the mountains. At some point, Jim Reveal, who wrote the treatment for the buckwheats in the fall of North America, and Don Mansfield, recently retired professor from College of Idaho, they looked at this more critically and realized it warranted taxonomic distinction. They described it as a new species in a new variety in 2014. As this slide shows, Areognum alvellifolium focarium, Craters of the Moon buckwheat, has this really super fuzzy white leaves. You can't really see the leaf surface. Whereas the variety of depressum has much thinner pubescence on the leaves, and you can actually see the green. So it's known only from Craters of the Moon National Monument. Where it occurs on these black cinder flats and slopes that are common in the northern part of the monuments. So a lot of what you see in that photo is President of Buckwheat. Creators of the Moon Monument itself is has a history of activity. It's formed over the last 15,000 years from eight or more separate volcanic eruptions events along the Great Rift. The most recent about 2,000 years ago. So it's reasonable to assume that this is a relatively recently evolved species. And the variety name Focarium, that's Latin for oven. And and it was given that in reference to the black cinder habitat of this plant, which in July could be cooking hot. We have almost 40 species of fleabanes or ridgeron in our flora, but none of them more rare or more limited distribution than this one, Salmon River fleabane or ridgeron salmonensis. It's recognized by its dark green, thin leaves, its lax stems, and then white flower heads that often fade to pink. Its habitat is, and also its very precise habitat requirements, which are these large, steep to vertical north-facing canyon walls. Where it grows kind of in crevices and cracks. These are habitat, these are sites that receive no or very little sunlight, even in the middle of summer. It's endemic to the lower 25 miles of the Middle Fork Salmon River and some of its tributaries, lower parts of its tributaries, and also the type location, which is on the main Salmon Canyon near the confluence with the Middle Fork. This plant was discovered by Pam and Steve Brunsfeld, people most of you know. And as Pam tells the story, in June of 1981, they traveled to the Middle Fork Salmon area, Middle Fork with a confluence with the salmon, to look at some plants, especially a gooseberry that Steve was interested in because he thought maybe it was a new species. So they go there, park their car just where it is right there, and Steve goes off and looks for his gooseberry, while Pam stays behind with their one-month-old screaming baby, Courtney. After a while, Courtney calmed down enough so Pam could go explore it in this little rock outcrop near where they were parked. And while doing that, she found this ridgeron she didn't recognize. And she couldn't key it out. When Steve got back to the car a little while later, he couldn't key it out either. He didn't know what it was. So eventually they sent it to a guy named Guy Neesom, who was a specialist in the Aster family. And several years later, in 1989, it was described as a new species, Ridgeron salmonensis. Another plant with a common with Salmon River in its name, the Salmon River Mountains penstemon, Penstemon salmonensis. We have four penstemons that are endemic to Idaho, including this one, which is one of the more recent additions to the Idaho endemic list, being described as a new species in 2017 by Noel Holmgren. It has it's a sub shrub with usually these weak sprawling stems. It also has tooth leaves, horseshoe-shaped anthers. It's in that group of the penstemons, and bluish flowers that bloom late spring, early summer. It's endemic to the central Idaho mountains, extending from the southeast corner of Idaho County into parts of Valley, Custer, and Lemhi counties. Its habitat is rocky, like a lot of penstemons, cliff ledges, cracks, talus, and other rocky habitats. This species was actually first collected in 1939 by Ray Davis, who was a professor at Idaho State University. And over the subsequent decades, it was collected several times more, but in almost all cases, it was identified as Penstemon diphyllus, which is another blue-flowered penstemon with serrate leaves and horseshoe-shaped anthers. But when Noel Holmgren was preparing his treatment for Flora Pacific Northwest second edition on the penstemons, he was looking at these specimens and realized they were different and actually represented a new species. The Salmon River penstemon, Salmon River Mountains penstemon, the leaves are oval with rounded at the apex, as opposed to this other similar looking species that have linear or lance-shaped leaves that are pointy at the tip. And also, you can maybe see in this picture what some of the leaves in Salmon River Mountain penstemon have little short petioles, but these other species that always attach directly to the stem. So a new addition to the Idaho endemics list in 2017. The East Central Idaho is unmatched for the number of endemics in the state. And that's in large part due to 11 species whose main distribution Salmon River Canyon from about Clayton upstream towards to Salmon and some of the lower canyon tributaries. Collectively, they're sometimes referred to as a chalice endemics. This is also one of the driest parts of the state. The canyon bottoms averaging maybe 8 inches of precip a year. And all these chalice endemics, they also share a common restriction to rocks of the chalice volcanic group, which represent kind of a diverse array of volcanic rocks associated with, you know, big eruptions and other tectonic activity back 40, 50 million years ago. Is that some of the habitat that they, you know, it's dry, harsh conditions, a lot of open space between plants oftentimes. Three of the chalice endemics are in the genus Astragalus, chalice milkvetch, Lemhi milkvetch, and Beckwith's milkvetch. Chalice milkvetch is kind of a dicariate branched plant with reddish stems, really super hairy, silvery leaves, and really small kind of yellowish flowers. And then these fruit pods that are two-chambered, as shown in that photo. Now my milkvetch is a more upright, tend to be larger plants. It also has reddish stems, but has larger flowers, and its fruit pods are one-chambered. This example here. And Beckwith's milkvetch is a plant that kind of, the stems kind of along the ground, and then they tip up, and it has fruit pods that are kind of leathery textured and kind of crescent shaped, so nothing like the other two. As this map shows all three species, you can see that they all share a distribution along the Salmon Canyon axis downstream from Clayton, excuse me. The chalice milkvetch also extends a little bit to the east into the Cimarroy, the foothills of the Cimarroy Mountains. The Lemhi milkvetch doesn't get as far up the Salmon River Canyon, but then cuts eastward into the East Fork Salmon River Canyon, which is really common. And there's a few populations over in the Lemhi Valley as well. Whereas Beckwith Fetch is mostly restricted to the Salmon River Canyon area. Well, I saved the last species I'm going to talk about is the most recently described species of Idaho endemics. In 2022, there were six species of Townsendia in Idaho flora. Townsendia is the genus in the Aster family. Well, we now have seven. This guy here, Lemhi Valley Townsendia, Townsendia lemhiensis. Well, I'm going to just go back one here. Actually, back in 2005, I think it was, our friend Curtis Bjork was out tromping around in the Lemhi Valley, and came across a Townsendia that he thought might represent a new species. So we sent photos to Christopher Lee and Janine Witten. These are two people who have worked on the genus Townsendia. They're taxonomists who've worked on this group of plants. And they thought that Curtis might be correct. But it took 5 years before the stars aligned and Chris and Jeanette could come out to Idaho and see the species in the field. And since there are several other Townsendias in the Lemhi Valley, they thought maybe it was just a funny looking hybrid at first. But you know, upon closer scrutiny, they realized it had distinct morphology and earlier flowering time than other species of Townsendia in the Lemhi area, and described it as a new species just a year ago, March of 2022. It's really a beautiful plant, white rays, a basal rosette of fuzzy leaves, and it's a series of characters in combination that distinguish it from other Townsendias, including it doesn't have an elongating stem. It's just only 1 to 2 inches tall. The hairs on the leaves are a mix of both the pressed and curly raised hairs. Has a persistent pappus and other technical features of the involucre size and things like that distinguish it. It's known from only, I think, three populations within a couple square mile area over in Lemhi County. All on BLM land, and that's it that we know about so far. Its habitat is this powdery rhyolitic ash, sparsely vegetated, and in these ash outcrops like this, they really what they represent are like islands, edaphic islands, surrounded by more densely vegetated sagebrush steppe habitat. The genus Townsendia is named after David Townsend, who was a botanist from Pennsylvania back in the day. And this is the description, part of the description that William Hooker wrote when he made the name Townsendia back in the 1800s. I have named the genus Townsendia to compliment David Townsend, Esquire of Westchester, Pennsylvania, who, having imbibed the most ardent love of botany from his friend and instructor, Dr. Darlington of the same city, has devoted his leisure hours to the science with eminent success. The plant now under consideration is peculiarly worthy of bearing his name because he has studied and ably discriminated the numerous Pennsylvania species of the allied genus Aster. Who writes like that anymore? That's what I want to know. You know, this is another plant that Curtis discovered just a couple miles from the road. And I think, you know, the lesson is there's still undoubtedly more species than idle to be discovered. You know, maybe some in some areas that have not been botanically explored, but also others in areas, these little nooks and crannies, odd habitats in areas that probably not too far from a road. It's what does it take to find, you know, something like a new plant? It does. I think it really just takes an interest in nature, you know, and a keen eye helps kind of be able to discriminate some differences. So I think, you know, the story of being able to find new species in Idaho still is a kind of a bell just to let us get outside, go for hikes, look at plants, and maybe we'll find something new. And with that, I just want to just acknowledge a lot of folks who supplied photos for this presentation. The list is there. I hope I got everybody. Any of the bad ones are mine. And with that, I say thank you very much for your attention. I can take any questions if you have any. Yes.
Is there any information about indigenous knowledge of these endemic plant uses in their culture?
Not that I'm aware of. I think some of the genera maybe have some information, but I don't know about these particular species.
Mike, would you repeat the question for the people on Zoom may not be able to
hear? Oh, I'm sorry. The question was, is there any indigenous people's knowledge about any of these endemic species? And Nancy?
The tendency now to split the species some of the DNA techniques, are we likely to see more endemics because they're split off?
So the question is, are we likely to see maybe more plants considered endemics due to a lot of the molecular work that's being done in plants and some of the splitting? That number 69 is a moving target. Maybe different next year by a couple of species, and that could be due to, you know, taxonomic discrepancies, new species being described or split, like you said, or plants that we now think are endemics being found in adjacent states that are no longer state endemics. So that it's a moving target, and that's probably one, you know, that's the ongoing molecular, you know, genetic work that's being done on plants probably will contribute to some of that fluctuations over time, probably. Yeah. Steve.
Can I talk about the finest scale at which the term endemic can be applied? We've got to have an upper limit that it no longer passes the blood test.
The question is, what do you call for distributions that are really very large? Is that kind of what you're asking?
Yeah, when, you know, you can say things are endemic to North America.
Right, you can say things are endemic to North America. You say, yeah. The term cosmopolitan is sometimes used, and that implies species that are pretty much found worldwide. There's some weeds that fit that term. That's a term that comes to my head, cosmopolitan. And there's also some natives. I think like bracken fern has almost a cosmopolitan natural distribution.
This is a comment from Zoom. I'm very much appreciating his inclusion of history and individuals. Please pass that on.
All right. Well, like I said, every plant has a story to tell, and that's part of this story.
In terms of stories, the swimmer and the newspaper.
Yes.
There has to be a joke there somewhere, right? You say who found that?
I did not. And that was Richard McNeil. Yes.
And
out of the Joseph plant.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
It's, if it's Joseph Plains, it's probably private, but I don't know for sure. And Swinger is, he named it in honor of a friend of his, who I can't remember their first name.
Who may have been a Swinger.
Yeah, the question was, who discovered the Swinger's biscuit route? That was Richard McNeil. Yeah. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you very much for coming, and hope you learned a couple of things tonight.